Betrayed, rejected, crucified, risen. Tonight I'm preaching on rejected. From the book of Luke, chapter 23, verses 18 through 25. I don't know if you have noticed in our culture, society in which we live today, there's been some pretty catastrophic things that have happened. Even today in Egypt, ISIS attacked Christians, churches. And I believe, wait a minute, is it last report I'd heard like 13 people plus that had lost their lives for the cause of Christ. And they were not worshiping Mohammed or Buddha or any other false gods. They were there worshiping the one true God. They were targeted. And I'm telling you, folks, the church is under a lot of attack by Satan and the world. But I want you to know the cross still stands tonight. And Jesus has not been dethroned. He is still King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But we find in our culture today that the cross is disappearing from our cities and even from our churches. That you don't even find. And you say, well, preacher, what's the big significance about a cross on the platform or in a building or something? That cross has been in this building for quite a few years. And that cross is going to remain in this building until Jesus comes, or we build a bigger church, or we do something else, something different. But even if that's the case, we take it with us. But in a broader, profounder, more troubling sense tonight, we have been voluntarily removing the cross. It's not so much from just the structures that we come to worship in, but more importantly, we have been removing the cross from our hearts and our minds. It is no longer the focal point of our life. In other words, Christ is taking a back seat to the things of the world. And silently and steadily, we find in a stealth manner that we have slipped the cross out of our preaching and out of our singing and from our daily living. And I'm glad we still can sing about, declare the cross. I'm glad some of the most exciting messages I think I have ever preached has been about the cross. And it seems like it all focuses back to the cross. And whatever the area of our lives that we're living in, whatever we're going through, we can always come back to Jesus. And there we can find the help that we need. As a result of this disappearance of the cross that's fading from our collective conscience, we find that really we're living in a generation and a time where Christlessness, crosslessness, has become more manifold. It's become more commonplace from that standpoint. And so some of the cases of well-intentioned efforts we find to reach the postmodern American for Christ is produce really a crossless version of Christianity. We're trying to reach people with something that doesn't have the blood, the cross, or Jesus attached to it. You take away that, you don't have anything. The church is built on Jesus. Our lives are built on Jesus. Our salvation is built on the atoning blood that He has supplied for us. So the cross of Calvary, I contend, is crucial. I also contend that it is the Calvary's crucified Lamb, which is the Lord Jesus Christ, is where in a bankrupt culture in which we're living in today, a fallen race where people are following sins, And all the other things, you know, thank God we have a Christ we can come to. Thank God that He still forgives sins. But commonplace in so many of the areas of religion today, that's become obsolete. We're using other strategies and ways and marketing schemes in order to allure people into churches. You know, you got to have the right combination. You've got to have the right marketing tools. You've got to have the right look, the right smell. You've got to have the right lighting, and you've got to have the right appeal to make people want to come to church. Whatever happened to coming to church because you love the Lord? Really, that's what our faith is built on, isn't it? Well, Golgotha's more than just a singular site of Satan's defeat. Realizing that it's more than just one place where you and I can find adoption and restoration. One of the greatest stories of the cross is that Jesus did more than just bear our sins. I find multiple things at the cross. I find healing at the cross, not only for our souls, but for our bodies. I find restoration. I find a refreshing, a revival. I find our minds can be changed. Our hearts can be changed today. Because you know what? Jesus bore the greatest consequence of our sin, and that's the shame that we carry. See, this is something that we've forgotten about in the world that we're living in. Sin brings consequences. And one of the greatest consequences of sin is that it brings a horrible shame to our lives. It's at the cross where our conscience is cleansed. And all that deep defilement of sin, thank God, is washed away. I like the old song, and we'll probably sing it by the time we get to the end of the communion. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Folks, if we leave the cross and Christ and the blood out of what we believe, we don't have nothing. Nothing left. Thank God Jesus died on the cross for us. And what a glorious time that we celebrate what he did at the cross. But this is just not a once a week in a year occasion that we celebrate. Every day, just not the first day, but every day is a resurrection day because of the relationship we have with Christ. Tonight, in this little 1 week series that I'm preaching, we continue from what we preached on this morning, talking about Peter and the fact that three times he basically betrayed the Lord. Now tonight I'm dealing with the subject of rejected. There is a character tonight in the picture of the scriptures tonight that we see that was rejected. Now, we may think tonight, oh, that's Jesus, because the word says in John, he came unto his own and his own received him not. That's not what I'm talking about. Let's go to Luke 23, 18 through 25. And they cried out all at once, saying, away with this man, and release unto us Barabbas, who for certain sedition made in the city, and for murder was cast into prison. I mean, he was a criminal. I mean, no doubt about it tonight. Pilate, therefore, willing to release Jesus, spake again to them, but they cried, saying, crucify him, crucify him, talking about Jesus. And he said unto them the third time, why? What evil hath he done? I have found no cause of death in him. I will therefore chastise him and let him go. He said, you know, I'm just make a spectacle of him. We'll have him beat, and we'll make his life a shame before, and then we'll just be away with him, and we can get back to life in the routine. That was not the case. And they were instant with loud voices requiring that he might be crucified, and the voices of them that were of the chief priests prevailed. There was something going on here other than just Pilate pleading the case for Jesus, but there's something else that I find in these scriptures tonight. He's also covering his back because he is politically minded that he's got to protect his position. And Pilate gave a sentence that it should be as they required. And he released unto him that for the sedition and murder that was cast into prison, whom they had desired, but he delivered Jesus to their will. Now, we know what the will of the people would be, because the people would require that Jesus would be crucified. Now, we really need tonight for the Holy Spirit this evening to bring the weight of these passages to bear in our lives, to show us tonight really what is being done here in this instant. I'm convinced that Christians need their hearts awakened tonight to the truth of God's Word. It's like we become asleep and we need to be awakened. We need a shaking. We need an awakening. We need for the fires of revival once again to sweep through the church and to stir us up for Christ. This account in Scripture is filled actually with real drama. Now, I know tonight when we say drama, we immediately go to, drama like on the Facebook? That's not the kind of drama I'm talking about here. I'm talking about real drama of what occurred at that day. So as Luke is writing here the narrative of the life of Christ, and then he moves through his life onto this place of crucifixion, then Luke makes it possible, and it's done by the leadership of the Holy Spirit, that we should identify with so many characters that are in and around what's happening here. So the crucifixion, understand this, and I'm not going to go into the detail of the crucifixion, that's for Wednesday night, but it was a brutal form of punishment that was basically invented by the Persians but perfected by the Romans. So even the Jews, they recognized that cursed is the man that hangs on the tree. Now, that being the case tonight, before the crucifixion, we've got tonight to first identify some characters around what is happening here. So there was Judas Iscariot, who sold Jesus out to death for money, for 30 pieces of silver. Then there are even people today who, folks, this is terrible, but when the money is right, they basically cash in Jesus. They do it, and they only use church and Christianity and things that are related to the church as a means of appropriating and getting gain to themselves. That's not what your Christianity is about tonight. Your Christianity is not about you. As a matter of fact, your whole life is not about you. The Word of God says you have been bought with a price. You've been paid for in full. You've been made by the Creator. And tonight you belong to Him. And therefore tonight your life should be about Him, not about the things of this world. The things of this world are of no value. Not only tonight temporary, as far as in a temporal capacity of this world, but eternally it is of zero value. Folks, tonight we've got to set our sights, our hearts, our minds, our lives tonight on the Lord Jesus Christ, who tonight purchased our redemption, who made a way where we had no way, who delivered us from the consequences, the condemnation, and the shame of sin. And thank God tonight we have such a Savior to look to. Then we think about that was Peter, who really loved Jesus. But in a moment of weakness, Peter broke down. You know tonight, folks, don't ever think tonight you're beyond that place in your life. You're not as strong as I told you this morning as you may perceive that you are. As a matter of fact, we're weak, we're broken, we're poor. But only in Christ are we tonight given the riches of God in our relationship with Him. I'm kind of like that old songwriter, take this whole world, but give me Jesus. Amen. Because this is temporary. This is just a place we're passing through. Man, we got a far better place to go. And all to know tonight that we have a heaven. Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. See, I'm not going to heaven because of the mansions. You're not either. You're not going because of gates of pearl and a street of gold and glistening walls of diamonds. You're going there because you're going to see the one who hung on the tree, who was hung up for our hang-ups of sin, who delivered us from the very clutches. I mean, Satan had a grip on us. He was a part of our heart, our mind, our life. He had control of us. But when Jesus, hallelujah, when you called upon the righteous God that He is, when you received Him into your heart and your life, thank God the devil moved out and the power of the Holy Spirit moved in. You now are a child of the King. Folks, I'm telling you tonight, if we're Christians, we need to start living like what we proclaim that we tonight possess. So there was Peter, and then there Judas, you know, where Judas betrayed, Peter denied. And then there were the chief priests, for they could not stand Jesus. They couldn't stand anything that He was about because He was a threat to them. Everything they stood for crumbled in the presence of Jesus. Why? Because they were building their own castles of their own lives. And Jesus brought all that down. Because if your life is not about Him, your life is about nothing. Also, there's Herod. Now, Herod and Pilate tonight were interested in their political aspirations. They were thinking about their careers. They wanted to move up the ladder of success, governmentally speaking. So they were willing to step on anyone, but being politically correct to do that which appeased the people to keep their political office, but also tonight that they were secure in where they were as far as that job was concerned. So they don't want to do anything. That's why Pilate kept fooling around with us. And you remember in the Word of God, that God's Word even tells us that Pilate's wife sent a messenger and said, leave that just man alone. Well, in his political desires and aspirations, he tried to work around that, but it didn't work in that capacity. Herod mocked him. The people, they railed against him. And the soldiers, they would beat him to the point that his body was a bloody mask. And the women would even mourn at him as he hung there on the cross. There was so much drama playing out before the cross. So many things that were going on that, you know, I've said before, I would love to have gone back in that time and lived in that era. I'm not really sure if I would want to do that. Because I would probably have been one of those in the crowd crying, crucify him. You know, then there are the two other characters, Pontius Pilate and a murderer, a thief, a crook by the name of Barabbas. I mean, Barabbas was basically prime time for the cross himself. So it was Pilate who put Jesus on trial. Three times Pilate said Jesus was innocent. He was declaring the innocence, but he was doing it in a manner that he did not cause any threat to his position. So Barabbas was a man who is mentioned actually in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all four Gospels. So he's called a killer in the Word of God. He's called a thief, a rebel, a sinner. And that's exactly what he is. But folks, all those things come down and equal to the equation that whatever he was in murder and thievery or anything else, it all equals tonight. He was a sinner. As all of us are tonight. We've all sinned. The Word says we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. There's none righteous, no, not one. So therefore, Barabbas in the halls of justice is rightly condemned to die. He should have gotten death. There was no question about it. He would have probably occupied the cross that Jesus was placed upon. There were two other thieves, one on the left, one on the right, and then the center cross. But what did Jesus do? This is what's so wonderful. Jesus took his place. Think about that for a moment. Jesus took the place of Barabbas. And because of the Passover, as you know, historically speaking, it was the custom to release a prisoner at that time for Passover. So one man that basically who was innocent in custody, and then you'd have another man who was guilty in custody. The man who was innocent was Jesus Christ. He was guilty of one thing, of love in the nth degree. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Oh, what love! For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So it's not a question here, because John went on to say in 1 John, he said, God is love. Now I like that, because it means that he just wasn't love dying on the cross. It just doesn't mean he is going to be love when we see him face to face. It means every day he's still love. Amen. He is our present help. He's the one tonight that loves us. Tonight when the world kicks you to the curb, when the world tonight spits on you, when the world tonight curses you, it's Jesus who picks you up, amen, and loves you and carries you through the storms of life, amen. Oh, friend, tonight, how blessed we are to have such a Savior as this one known as Jesus. So Pilate wanted to release, he literally wanted to release Jesus and crucify Barabbas. But the people wanted Jesus to die. He was a threat to their lifestyle. And they thought when he came and made his triumphal entry into Jerusalem, as we celebrate today on Palm Sunday, they thought, oh, we're going to get a new earthly king. He didn't come to be an earthly king. He came as he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He came to be the king and the Lord of their life. And so therefore, Barabbas would be released as a sinner, and they would crucify Jesus in his place. Now, they, I believe, even ordered additional punishment for Jesus. He took the cat of nine tails. He took 39 lashes. And in a literal sense tonight, Barabbas would say, Jesus died for me. Really? I would like to have seen, you know, I pointed out this morning from the scriptures when Peter and the rooster had crowed three times. The scripture talks about, and then he turned, and there was Jesus, and he saw him. Can you imagine the piercing look that Jesus had through the soul of Peter? Now listen, can you imagine tonight, this man, do you think there was something about Barabbas that he knew that he was guilty? I believe so. Do you believe there was something tonight that just welled up in his soul that pointed to the fact this man, Jesus, would take my place on the cross? I mean, he's innocent. He's not stolen anything. He's not killed anyone. He has not committed any type of thievery or any other type of anything that was in a violation of the law. We're not here to listen, folks. If you look at it in the true sense, Barabbas is a form of the gospel. Because we are not here to feel good about ourselves. We are here tonight to look to the gospel tonight. What is the fact that Christ died for sinners. And Luke also reminds us that Jesus came to seek and to save that which is lost. That's us. You've got to come to grips with yourself tonight. And if you're saved, I pray you are, and I trust you are. You've got something to rejoice about tonight. Man, Easter has a special meaning to your heart. I mean, every Sunday, every day, man, I tell you, just think about how great our God is. That He would love us and care for us and provide for us, and that we have a relationship with Him, and that we can name Him as our Savior. And we know, beyond a shadow of a doubt, we have a home reserved for us in heaven tonight. Oh, my God, we're so blessed beyond measure tonight. God's been so good to us. Amen. So Barabbas gives us real flesh and blood, a real flesh and blood picture of the gospel, the hope that we have in Christ. Hallelujah. Jesus died for all sinners. Amen. For every person. Now let me show you a couple points here tonight. The gospel is freedom replacing guilt. The freedom is Christ tonight. Well, I'm an American, I'm free. Well, that doesn't make you free. The only real true freedom is the relationship that we have with Christ. Remember in John, whom the Son sets free is what? Free indeed. There was no question that Barabbas was a guilty sinner. All the evidence proved that. There was no doubt he was guilty of the crimes that he committed. He was guilty like tonight we are guilty. But preacher, I haven't killed anybody. I haven't robbed anybody. I haven't done anything tonight that has broken the law. But let me tell you what you have done. You have sinned in the sight of Almighty God. You have transgressed God's law. You have tonight crossed the line in disobedience, as we all have tonight. And you know what, God, if He gave us what we really deserve tonight, it would not be tonight grace, and it would not be His love, and it would not be His forgiveness. It would be His justice. Tonight we'd all wind up straight in hell. But I'm glad tonight He made a way. Oh, praise God. I'm glad He made a way for you and I tonight that we don't have to die in our sins and go to hell. As guilty as Barabbas was, and you know, if you look, and I tried to do a little bit of research, I mean, it's only so much you can do about these Bible characters, especially like people like Barabbas that just kind of appear and they just kind of vanish into the pages. But I tried to do a little research on him. I don't believe that Barabbas started the way that he wound up. I really don't. Even his name, if you'll do a little study on Barabbas, his name tonight, it reflects that he came from really a God-fearing background. And so in the Aramaic tonight, his name meant, just get this tonight, son of the father. Now tonight, we'd say, sorry dog, sorry sinner, a thief, a murderer. And he was probably caught up, you know, in a position. And he was even brought up in godly ways, but as so many people do, and I could give you a list as long as from here down to the end of the street and on out, of people who've gone astray on God. See, you got to guard what you got. You tonight, the devil is there at every corner that you turn. He is at every opportunity that is before you. He'll do everything that he can tonight to try to derail you, because tonight he does not want you serving God. Now, it's not about you that he's after. It's about defaming tonight in any way that he can damage the name of Jesus. Because the Word of God says tonight, he stands and he is an accuser of the brethren. He loves to accuse, you know, this one's yours, God, but look at the way they're living. They're not faithful to you. They don't love you. They don't serve you. And then he comes to us and he tells you, man, if God was so good, why did he let you come down with this illness? If God's so good, why are you having to face this trial? And I mean tonight, he is very methodical in his plan to try to derail our Christianity. I'm glad tonight that my hope is built tonight on solid ground. And that's the Lord Jesus Christ. Upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Thank God tonight we're safe in Christ. But you've got to be vigilant tonight. You've got to put on the whole armor of God, as Ephesians 6 tells us. You've got tonight to be watchful. And that's why Jesus warns us. He says, watch and pray. You've got to keep your mind, your heart, your life. Because let me tell you, Satan tries in every fashion and form. You say, does he ever bother you? All the time. All the time. He'll do everything. And buddy, let me tell you, he knows every little soft button you got that sets you off. He knows mine is mechanical things that don't work right. Oh, let me tell you, that modem almost yesterday went through the window pane. I have that much patience with mechanical things, technical things that doesn't work. I could not do your job, Tom, because I'd be fired on the first day. Because a computer would have went out a window somewhere because it didn't. And don't we get aggravated when they're not going as fast as we want them to go? I thought, my Lord, wake up! You grab the screen and say, come on, man, do something. And it just sits there and that little thing goes, Oh, yeah, you shake the mouse. And let me tell you what I do with a mouse, Debbie. I not only shake the, yeah, that's right. I'll go, hurry up, do something. And it does do something, nothing. Amen. But anyway, this guy was probably brought up in a godly home, but somewhere he got away from the faith that God had placed before him. You know, I made this comment this morning. Bad company corrupts good character. You run with the wrong crowd, I'm going to tell you right now. As the old fellow said, it's going to rub off on you. Perhaps there was a knot, you know, in his heart that he couldn't untie. There was something that he just couldn't come to grips with. And I contend there are a lot of people out there that has named the name of Jesus, but they've gotten tied up in the ways of the world, and there's a knot in their heart they just cannot get untied. And so that's true in so many of our society today. You've got to be careful that your heart does not become cold. And if you're not careful, the next thing you know, because of the events in life, because of the circumstances that you've gone through, because of the trials that you've faced, because of everything that you have encountered, all of a sudden, if you're not careful, your heart can begin slipping away from God. You got to stay on top today of your relationship with the Lord. Amen. You cannot take this relationship for granted. Sometimes our actions don't give testimony, really, that our life is lived for Jesus, does it? A little word slips out our mouth. A little action slips out of our mouth. What happened to Barabbas? You know what? It can happen to you too. Your sin, be honest now, and know that your sin will find you out. It'll catch up with you. Like Barabbas, we don't deserve anything. You don't deserve heaven. I don't deserve it. We don't deserve forgiveness, but blessed be the name of the Lord who gives it anyway. Amen. So his name reflected Son of the Father. But Barabbas didn't deserve the Father's love. Folks, neither did we. We did not deserve his love. You need to move away from a religion today that's about you. And that's what religion has become so much in our society and our generation. We need to turn to a faith that is always about God and is about changing hearts and lives. And if we'll turn to God, let me tell you what, He'll work a miracle in your life. Sin is so separated and torted today and abused the hearts of people to the point they don't even know, you know, they don't even know how to get back to God anymore. Actually, we are all a Barabbas in one sense. We're guilty as a sinner. Every person is. And that's bad news. But I'm glad tonight it's not the end of the news. Amen. Jesus said in Matthew 9:13, but go ye and learn what that meaneth. I will have mercy and not sacrifice, for I am not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. So praise God, Jesus came to take your place under the waterfall of God's judgment tonight. And He did that at the cross. He suffered as no man had ever suffered. And that's God's grace. That's the God's riches at Christ's expense. That's the price that's been paid. That we tonight can be under grace. And as long as Satan, he'll shout, but he cannot touch you. Just turn a deaf ear. Don't listen to him. In this passage, the only one guilty, really, you think about Barabbas, though, in one sense, is pardoned. And this is amazing. He's set free. Do you realize that Jesus has set you free? And not only has He set you free, but Paul talks about it in Romans, I believe it's Romans 5. He talks about tonight, we have been justified. See, the fact is, Barabbas was pardoned of what he had committed. Murder and theft. And God only knows what else. He was pardoned. But it didn't remove the fact that he still committed the murder that he had committed. He was still guilty. Oh, let me tell you about the grace of God and what it does for you tonight. We too are pardoned. But in that pardon that God gives us, we are justified. In that justification that we receive from the Lord, that means tonight, it's not the fact that God wipes the slate clean. It's the fact tonight God gives you a new slate. What was against you is gone. Thank God it's cast as far as the east is from the west. There's no evidence tonight. But Satan likes to dredge up our past life. All those bad things you've done. All those sins that you committed. All those bad thoughts that you thought. All those deeds that you had done. Let me tell you tonight, if it's under the blood, brother, it's gone. And you're justified just as you had never committed that sin. So Barabbas, even though he was pardoned, let me tell you what. He was pardoned, but he was still guilty. Thank God tonight, we have been forgiven, pardoned and justified, and now the sin is not held against us. Amen. That's what our God has done for us. That's the promise tonight that we have in these scriptures. The overruling hand of God ordered tonight the events of the trial that was going to take place. See, there was a purpose. God permitted these things to happen. They had to declare that really, in everything that had happened here, Jesus was innocent. The perfect Son of God died in the place of a sinner. He died in your place and mine. He took your faults, your sin, your shame, your guilt, and exchanged it, and He gave you freedom. Hallelujah. Not freedom to go out and act and live any way you want to do, because you're held accountable by the Scriptures and by the presence of the Holy Spirit before the very throne room of God. And you're accountable to the Word of God. So Pilate used a word. I like this word that he used. It's called R-E-L-E-A-S-C. What does it spell? Release. Release. He released the sinner for the sinless one. That's exactly what he did. And what Jesus did in the place of Barabbas is what he came to do for you and I tonight. He paid that debt in full for you and I tonight. He will take the punishment of your guilt tonight and the sin, and He will put everything tonight that is against you, and He nails it to the cross and then declares you innocent through the blood of Jesus Christ tonight. All that happened at the cross. Then tonight, secondly, the gospel is life replacing death. You can feel the utter brutality that's in this story. You read the account, you examine what the Word tells you tonight. Crucifixion was used to keep peace in Rome. So now Barabbas Here's the murderer. He was guilty of the nth degree, and he would be getting what he deserved. But the life of Barabbas is a picture, really, the life of every sinner, every person unredeemed, unsaved tonight. We're sinners by birth, one. We're sinners by choice, two. We choose to sin. The devil didn't twist your back, twist your arm, make you, and put it behind your back to make you sin. You chose to sin. Oh, I know we use all the reasons. You know, well, you don't know what happened at work today. And by the way, my wife and I, we had a big spat, man. I just had to do it. No, that's still no justification. You can never justify sin. Amen. So therefore, we have broken the law of God. We tonight have violated God's word. And our sins must be punished tonight, for that is tonight the justice of God. That is the way it works. And you can turn away that offer of God tonight, and you can take tonight the punishment, and you tonight can take all the guilt that is against you tonight and place it, glory to God. You tonight can take everything that is against you, and you can place it on God, His Son, at the cross. But people reject that. I've never understood. How can you reject such an offer? He's taken your condemnation, your death, your sin, your shame, and your hell. And He's given you life and an eternity in heaven in place of it. And what does He require? He just requires that you love Him and serve Him. And this is the amazing part of even that. He will enable you and empower you to do that. Paul said in Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. So therefore tonight, if you reject God's grace, you're going to stand under the condemnation of God. But thanks be to God for John 3:16, 17, and 18. Let's quote John 3:16. How's it go? For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, but what? May be saved. Then He says in verse 18, He that believeth on Him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. So if you're lost, you're standing under God's judgment. Every lost person is standing under God's judgment. If you don't believe in Christ, you are standing under the condemnation of God. Praise God, Jesus took what Barabbas deserved, and thank God He took his place. But not only did He take the place of Barabbas, He even saved another thief while He was on the cross. You know, you think about the humanity of Jesus. Would you have done that? While you were there and you'd been beaten and your body was a bloody mess, you were aching, your joints were hurting, and your face was bleeding, and they planted that crown of thorns on your head, and that rough, rugged cross, those splinters were driven long and deep into your flesh. You hurt. And you think some guy standing or some guy hanging on a cross next to you says, hey, remember me when you come into your kingdom. What would we say? Sorry, buddy, you're on your own. I got enough problems over here. Figure your own way out. But what did Jesus do? He said, today, you will be with me in paradise. What does all that say? Jesus, even on the cross, saved a lost sinner. And not only that, but hanging on the cross, one of the seven sayings of the cross is, Father, what? Forgive them, for they know not what they do. Let me hurry up and finish here. He took our place. I don't know if that moves your heart tonight. And if you don't feel any sensitivity to that, something's wrong with your salvation. I can't help but sometimes to get emotional about thinking about what Jesus has done for me, about the price that He paid, for the redemption that He has provided, for the atonement that He has secured. And realize tonight in Christ, life replaces death. Oh, I may die physically one day. Oh, but brother, I'm so glad I'm going to be so alive on the other side. Amen. He took your place. He died your death. He occupied your grave. And he gives you and I his forgiveness. So when we turn to Christ, we're no longer rejectors. Now we are redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. And I don't know about you, but I'm so glad tonight that he loved me with such a love. Because of Jesus, you and I can live tonight. Doesn't mean you're problematically free of trouble and trials in your life, but now you got somebody to cast your troubles on. Come tonight and experience the forgiveness, the restoration, the blessing that he has for you. If you're having struggles tonight, if you need answers in your life, if you need help, man, he is such a helper tonight. He can lift everything that is against you tonight. I'm glad that we can come to him because he is our only hope tonight. And if you've got Jesus, man, you've got it all. You've got everything that you need in life. Tonight, whatever's on your heart, bring it to him. Father, thank you tonight just for a time that we can spend some time in your word talking about what Jesus did for us. Thank you that, Lord, even through the betrayal, even through the rejection, thank God, God's plan of salvation prevailed. And Jesus, yes, died on the cross, but the cross couldn't hold him. The death of the cross couldn't defeat him. Even the grave couldn't conceal him. For he is alive. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he is alive in our heart tonight. Thank you, Lord. Now, Lord, we still live in a robe of flesh tonight. And with that robe of flesh comes trials and challenges and difficulties of life. But I'm glad tonight that you are there tonight to take whatever is on our heart. And Lord, give us a peace that will surpass all understanding in place of it tonight. Now, Lord, as we stand to our feet, and Lord, we have a song of invitation tonight. I just pray that the Spirit of God will move on us this evening. And Lord, I just pray tonight that you will lift up your people, encourage their hearts, and show them the greatness and the realness of our God. And what you have provided in Jesus' name.